this time, mark your books, hymn number 593. Yes. Song of invitation. And if you'd be so kind after doing so, please turn with me to hymn number 648. 648.
My precious Savior, suffer, reign, and come be born and all.
Jesus gave his life for ransom yonder on Calvary.
On the Calvary.
Tell the Lord. prayers up.
That's the only way that we over and glory land.
Blessed are the poor, for yours is the kingdom.
it now, for ye shall laugh.
Blessed number 22. Blessed are you when men hate you, when they exclude you from exclude you and revile you and cast you out. Your name as evil, the Son of Man, Satan.
Rejoice ye in that day, and be for joy. For behold, your reward is great in heaven. For in the like manner did their fathers unto the prophets.
But woe unto you who are rich, for you have received your consolation.
Ye are full, for ye shall hunger. Woe unto you that laugh now, for ye shall mourn and weep. Well, of you.
So did their fathers to false prophets. Thank you for the reading. You know, when you start looking at Jesus, if you were to pick, if you were to choose one word that the whole Bible just hones in on throughout the Old Testament and New, it would be Jesus.
Yeah.
Because when he's not mentioned by name, there's some metaphor used to also represent him. Even in the Old Testament. Turn with me, if you will, to the book of Genesis. You should have a hard time finding that book. Genesis chapter 28, if you will. The 28th chapter of Genesis. While we're turning, I just want to say to our visitors, pick up where our announcer picked up, welcome you to our services. We hope that you're here for the first time, but you're not here for the last time.
Amen.
Yeah.
Most of us have visited at one point in time, and some of us are still here.
Amen.
So we're happy that God has blessed us to do so. We hope you'll be blessed likewise.
Amen.
As always, our goal, reach out to the hearts of everybody present, but especially those who are not members of the body of Christ.
Amen.
We want you to join us and be a part of the family of God, because God wants all of us in his family.
Amen.
It is his will that nobody be lost. All people, all persons be saved.
Sure.
Please, if you are not a member of the Church of Christ and you have someone talking to you about the church, please don't be offended, because we say to you there is one church.
Amen.
We're only saying to you what the Bible says.
Amen.
We realize that there will be a day when God will measure us, judge us by what's written in his book.
Amen.
And so it's important to realize that no one's picking at you, making fun of you, but just saying to you, you need to be where salvation really is.
Amen.
And you must be religious because you're reading the Bible.
Amen.
We're hoping that that leads you to a final decision to become a member of the Lord's body.
Amen.
In Genesis chapter 28, you should be there now. The Bible talks about Jacob leaving home, going to a land to choose a wife. And in this audience, I'm sure there are those of us who have made choices. Thank God that our choices, good choices, they've lasted. And we look around and say, thank you, Lord, that I made that choice. I made a choice and I was chosen also. And so as a result of that, we have a nice, wonderful relationship. God, of course, say amen.
Amen.
You don't want to be like the lady that went before the judge. You know, was asking for a divorce. The judge said, you was here just not too long ago. What a blessed relationship you're about to have. You want to get married and all that. And she said, and you talking about somebody introduced you to this man you met, and now you want a divorce? She said, well, let me say it this way. He was the most overly introduced man I ever met. So we don't want to be like that. We want you to be happy then.
Amen.
Introduced to you, and then you made a good choice.
Amen.
Jacob was going to look for a wife. Well, it was two things. He was really running from what he saw as well. You know, he had stolen his blessings, his brother's blessings, so now he's fleeing for his own life. And so he comes to a certain place, and it was what happened at that place that I want to place emphasis on this morning that was so very important to Jesus being prophesied to be a blessing to the world.
Mm-hmm.
Look at verse 28. Sure. Jacob. You know, he's the one traveling. And the Bible says, let's verse it up. We came to a certain place. Everybody see that?
Yes, sir.
And stayed there all night. Because the sun had set, and he took one of the stones out of the place and put it at his head. And he lay down in this place to sleep. Verse number 12, that he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and the top reached to heaven. And there were angels of God who were ascending and descending upon it. And behold, the Lord stood above and said, I am the Lord thy God, of God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob.
Amen.
And he said, in the land which you stay, which you lie, I will give to you as an inheritance. Amen. Now, I want you to go all the way to the Gospel of John, chapter 1, if you will. As I come in, probably going up when I read there. Here, Jacob has this dream. The Bible says he saw a ladder. It is emphasized that the ladder had a top to reach to heaven, and the bottom was on earth. And so the natural question would be, what does this mean? You know, he's looking at, he's dreaming a dream, and this ladder is there. So he looks at the ladder, and above that ladder stands God, looking down upon earth. And he identified himself as the Lord God of heaven. The Bible shows here that this ladder is really a metaphor for Jesus.
Amen.
And if you go to the Gospel of John, chapter 1, that's where it should be by now. And I'm going to ask for a flower thing to assist in this. I read verse number 51 of the Gospel of John. Now remember, John wrote several books. We want you to read chapter 1 of a book of the Gospel of John. And that is verse number 51. And notice the emphasis that is given there in that epistle. John chapter 1, verse number 51.
And he said unto him.
And he said unto him.
Verily, verily.
Verily, verily.
I say unto you.
I say unto you.
Hereafter. Ye shall see heaven open.
Ye shall see heaven open.
And the angels of God.
And the angels of God.
Ascending and descending.
Ascending and descending.
Upon the Son of Man.
Upon the Son of Man. Well, we know who the Son of Man is.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus. Right. And so what we have here, here's a metaphor of Jesus, who actually is God's son. And he was God's son in eternity. And so he was God's son even as a little baby in the manger. And don't ask me to explain that. The Bible tells us that he comes to the earth as a little baby in a manger. But he is very definitely still the Lord God of heaven.
Amen.
And the Bible says here that this ladder that he saw there represents the Son of God, the Son of Man. Now how does it do that? Well, first of all, remember, God made man perfectly, sinless, without any flaws at all. Was considered the highest of his creation out of all that he made. But then the day came when man sinned. And when he sinned, separated himself from God. Because sin always does that. And when a man is not in Christ, he's separated from God.
Amen.
And the separation not only is in this world, it's in the world to come. That means that there will be an eternal separation. You see, when we talk about dying, see, death, the very word means separation. But to die physically, every one of us must die.
Amen.
You know, the only reason why we won't die is that the Lord will come before we die. Amen. But it's been appointed, according to Hebrews 9, verse 27, it's been appointed that the man wants to die, then after this comes the judgment. Amen. So we're going to all have to die.
Amen.
It may not make us happy, but it's true. And so, with this idea of physically dying, when we die, there's a separation that takes place.
Amen.
The spirit separates from the physical body.
Yes,
the body goes into the grave, the spirit goes back to God again.
Mm-hmm.
And so we understand that. But the point is that there is a separation in the word death. But then there's also the thought that there can be an eternal separation. Mm-hmm. Now, eternal separation is that man not only dies and separates his physical body and spirit, but his spirit is separated from God forever and for all eternity.
Yeah.
Let me say to you, brothers and sisters, Christian friends, you don't want to have a position in life that will put you in a position of being separated from God for all eternity.
Yeah.
We don't have a clue of how bad that really is. Because we don't Mm. Because every breath we take is governed by God.
Amen.
Every step we make is governed by God.
Yes, sir.
So we don't have a way to determine how bad that really is, but I have a place where there is no separate, there is no connection with God at all, nothing but darkness and eternal darkness forever and ever. That's what it demands.
Amen.
But it's true. But the Bible says here, since man has sinned, then he's separated from God. Mm-hmm. You know. And Isaiah said it well when he said that God's arms are not short that he cannot save. Neither is his ears heavy that he can't hear, but your sins and the iniquities have separated you from God, therefore he won't hear you.
Amen.
You see. And so we hear this thing about just call on the Lord. Well, you can't just call on the Lord. You can't call on somebody you don't know.
Amen.
See, when you talk to God, it's out of a relationship. See, God doesn't deal with, God does not hear sinners. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Right.
Now, that's where they tell us that. And the Bible, Peter said, the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous.
Mm.
And his ears are against those that do evil. And so we know then that there needs to be a relationship between man and God. But who made it possible for us to have that relationship? Only Jesus.
Because
mm-hmm. once sin separates us, there was nobody that could give a sacrifice for sin that God would accept, except that of his own son.
Amen.
It was a hard thing. He sent his only son into the world. He did. And from childhood, we remember as children that golden text of Scripture, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son.
John 3:16.
Do not perish, but have
everlasting life. Amen.
Now the word believe it there is a continuous situation. It means that not only they understanding of God, but they're willing to obey God.
Amen.
When I believe something, I will follow through on what I believe.
Amen.
It's like you go to the doctor, he writes you a prescription, and you go home and you put the prescription on the shelf, never look at it anymore. But you didn't believe the doctor. But if you believe him, you take the medication. God said, I don't have no way to save you but through my son.
Mm-hmm.
You see? That's why he said, neither is there salvation in any other. There is none other name under heaven given among men whereby
we must be saved.
We must be saved.
Mm-hmm.
That name, of course, is Jesus. That's what salvation is. So we're looking at that ladder that suggests now that somebody has come.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody had made it possible that this separation between man and God has been taken care of by somebody who could pay the price.
Amen.
And that person was Jesus himself. When Jesus died on Calvary, you know, just look at the amazing things that happened. The very fact of time itself was affected by Jesus coming. Before Jesus came, you had B.C., or we say before Christ. Then you have A.D., Anno Domini, the word after death, after Christ comes and dies, everything changes. Life now can be made wonderful.
Amen.
But you got to be in Christ.
Amen.
You can't get in Christ without understanding the will of God, obey God's word, and the Bible says the Lord adds you to the church.
Amen.
And we're in a world now, strange world, that says things such as any church will do. Well, will any wife do?
Mm.
Will any car do?
Mm.
When there is a specific statement made by God, who are you going to believe, God or me?
Amen.
The answer one says it's all right. God says one church.
Amen.
One way.
Yes, sir.
You see. And I had a man tell me one day, well, you know, the Church of Christ folk just want to dominate folk, you know. But let me just put it this way. I'm going to say it nice and I'm going to smile so you can see my teeth. Now, Ephesians chapter 1. Now listen to this real good. Go on, read it again. The Bible said, even before time ever ticked 1 second, God had chosen to save in him. That's the fold then, that the church that we're talking about here had to come out of the mind of God. But let me ask you, can you read God's mind? I don't know anybody that can. So whatever in God's mind is only going to be there until he reveals it to us. And so when God reveals it, God revealed that salvation is to be in one place, it's in one church. And when he named out that place, he said it was chosen to be eternity.
Amen.
So if God made that choice way back there, how would somebody come along in later years and build something and claim it to be belonging to God.
Amen.
You see, that's what man thinks. That's not what God says. God says told the apostles now, Jesus told the apostles, you go to Jerusalem and wait. What are you going to wait for? You got to wait for the coming of the Holy Spirit. Amen. What's he going to do? When he comes, he will give you power. Acts chapter 1. And then you go preach the gospel to the whole world.
Right.
You see. Up until before the gospel is preached in the fullness sense of the word, they only preached to the household of the Jews.
That's right.
Matthew chapter 1. Go to only to the household of the Jews.
Mm-hmm.
You see. Later on, there will be a position to everybody, no matter Jew or Gentile, everybody will be invited into the same plane.
Mm-hmm.
So the Bible says we can be one in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
But there's nobody else can unite the world with God again but the Lord Jesus.
Amen.
Now let me ask you a question. Does he have a plan to tell us what church he built? Does he have a right to tell us how to get into that church? Doesn't he have a right to warn us that there will be false prophets in the world we live? They'll claim to be the Christ. But he said they'll come to you as sheep, a wolf in sheep clothing. But we have to remember something. That Jesus said, I am the way. I am the truth and I am the life. No man can come to the Father but by me. Somebody tell you there's another way, they're trying to fool you. And you need to take the word of what the Bible says. Because Jesus said, I'm the way. And you know, even Peter, he's one of the 12, remember? Not only one of the 12, he's one of the three among the 12. That special group that's always with the Lord, wherever he